Welcome to First United Lutheran Church. This is the message from Sunday. It's our prayer that this message touches your heart and helps to guide you in your life. Let's listen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. Those bells chiming kind of remind me, one of our favorites has a birthday today. Miss Carol. It's your special day. I think we should sing happy birthday to Carol Poole. There's a few announcements in the bulletin, so I just encourage everyone to take a peek at that. Today's our annual meeting right after church. There's a couple poinsettias in the back that pretty much probably need to be rescued today, or they should probably find their way to the garbage can, but they're back here through the door on the right. If anyone did not get their poinsettia after Christmas, there are a few back there still. And then on the back, just if you turn and look at the clock, just around the corner from the clock, there's a sign-up sheet for snow shoveling. So if anybody has some spare time or wants to partner up with someone else, I know there are still some empty spots on the shoveling sign-up list. Any other urgent messages or announcements that did not make the bulletin? All right. Then if you would, let's open with a word of prayer this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day to come together to worship you. Lord, it always feels so good to come into this house of worship and see friendly faces and visit with those that we care about. Lord, I just ask that you open our minds and our hearts today as we hear your word, as we read through scripture, as we hear Dean's message today. Lord, I just ask that you always help us to always be seeking your guidance in our decisions each day. And as we interact with those around us, help us to show love and kindness and open ourselves to hear what others are saying so that we can come together to serve you well. Lord, I especially pray for some of our friends who need some health and healing. So we keep Paula, Sally, Penny, Bob, Alex, and Sandy in our prayers. Lord, we also lift up Gary and Minnie at Feed My Lambs. We ask that you continue to guide them as they serve you in a mission capacity. Lord, give them the right words. Help them to point people to the right parts of scripture to help them to come to an understanding of you and to open their hearts to you. Lord, I especially want to give a special thanks to our Sunday school teachers who show up each and every Sunday preparing a time for our kids and just sharing your word with them so they can tuck those verses away in their heart. Lord, we know that every time we hear your word, it takes hold and it builds upon each other. So I just thank you for that group. In your name we pray. Amen. Our scripture this morning from Psalm is Psalm 62. And it just was reminding me, in Sunday school during opening, we have this book that we read a little bit from. And the book is titled, I think, What Every Child Needs to Know About Prayer, or something like that. And so each Sunday we read a little snippet to learn about prayer and how prayer helps us to talk to God and get closer to God. And the last section lately for the last couple months has been focusing on Psalms and how we can pray the Psalms and how the Psalms help us to pray and know God better. And so it's been fun to read that with the kiddos and to think about that. So I just encourage everyone as I read the Psalm today to or anytime you're reading Psalms, it's just a great way to pray, is to pray the scripture. So I just was thinking about that this morning and wanted to share that with you. So this morning, Psalm 62. Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Truly he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. How long will you assault me? Would all of you throw me down, this leaning wall, this tottering fence? Surely they intend to topple me from my lofty place. They take delight in lies. With their mouths they bless, but in their hearts they curse. Yes, my soul, find rest in God. My hope comes from him. Truly, he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will not be shaken. My salvation and my honor depend on my God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in him at all times, you people. Pour out your hearts to him, for God is our refuge. Surely the lowborn are but a breath, the highborn are but a lie. If weighed on a balance, they are nothing. Together, they are only a breath. Do not trust in extortion or put vain hope in stolen goods. Though your riches increase, do not set your heart on them. One thing God has spoken, two things I have heard. Power belongs to you, God, and with you, Lord, is unfailing love. And you reward everyone according to what they have done. Our opening songs this morning, our first one is My Lighthouse. I bet the words will be up on the screen for us.
Yes, and actually, while we are, I'm gonna pull an audible this morning. I would like to do Thy Word first, which is the next song, and then because I'm gonna use My Lighthouse for the children's sermon at the same time. So I would like to have everyone, I think probably would just remain seated for this. I'd like to. Beth made a really good point about praying the Psalms, and this, the word or the song "Thy Word" comes straight out of Psalm 119. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And then we'll put a beat to it. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light. You're the light unto my path.
Now I'd like to invite the puppet master up, and we will do My Lighthouse. And any kids, I guess, that are up here too. Hang on, I better sit down. Okay. Hi, good morning. What a gang we got here today. Today's song is going to be about a lighthouse. A lighthouse. You know what's a lighthouse? It's a house with light in it?
Yeah.
I suppose that's probably true. And I should have had a good picture of a lighthouse, but I think in our mind we can have a pretty solid picture of what a lighthouse is. And so now I would like the congregation to rise and stand with us as you're able, and we will sing My Lighthouse. Okay, man. Okay. That we're all up here busting a move on the song. So All right, stick around. We got some food for you. Oh, boy. I hope we got some food.
Ooh.
Oh, okay, here we go, here we go, here we go. Dig in, there you go. Here, I should let Megan do this. She's much better at it.
I'll invite the ushers up for the offering plates, please.
Those are good ones.
To just say hello and good morning to your neighbors before we sit down and move on with confession.
Good morning.
Good morning. It's so fun to hear everyone's chatter and the smiling faces. That's awesome. Please join me as we confess our sins together. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you to confess to you that we have grievously sinned and fallen short of your glory. We have not loved you above all things or our neighbor as ourselves. We confess these and other things to you. Grant to us your mercy and grace, and help us to live our lives in the way that honors you most. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. We read in 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 and 9, that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. God declares to us in Psalm 103, 10 through 12, that he has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our guilty deeds. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his mercy toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our wrongdoings from us. The lessons this morning, I'm not sure who the reader, oh, there she comes.
Jonah chapter 3, verse 1 through 10. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim it to the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down to dust. This was the proclamation he issued in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let the people or animals, herds or flocks, taste anything. Do not let them drink, but let the people and animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring them destruction that he had threatened. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 29 through 35. What I mean, brothers and sisters, is that the time is short. From now on, those who with wives should live as they do not, those who mourn as if they did not, those who are happy as if they did not, those who buy something as if it was not theirs to keep. Those who use the things of the world as not engrossed in them, for this world in the present form is passing away. I would like you to be free from concern. An unmarried man is concerned about the Lord's affairs, how he can please the Lord. But a married man is concerned about the affairs of this world, how he can please his wife, and his interests are divided. An unmarried woman or virgin is concerned about the Lord's affairs. Her aim is to be devoted to the Lord in both body and spirit. But a married woman is concerned about the affairs of this world, how she can please her husband. I am saying this for your own good. Do not restrict you, but that you may live in a right way and undivided in devotion to the Lord.
Audrey, that was super. I tell you what, gave you about 20 minutes worth of reading to do and you nailed it. Thank you very much. Very well done. I'd like to invite you to stand then, and we will, as we do each Sunday, we'll take a second here, and we'll be talking about our faith in this and the kinds of things that we believe, and how interestingly totally opposed they are to the things that the world believes. So let's think about that as we go through this. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate. He was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Interesting set of beliefs, are they not? So I will, at this time, we'll also continue with the reading of the gospel. We'll remain standing out of respect for Mark, chapter 1, verses 14 through 20. You kind of notice a theme here, especially coming out of Jonah and what we're going to read here. Some of the most interesting characters in the whole Bible, all lumped together, and they got something pretty important in common. We'll talk about that this morning. After John, the Baptist, after John the Baptist was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee proclaiming the good news of God. The time has come, he said. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent, believe the good news. And as he walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, as in Peter, and his brother Andrew, casting a net into the lake because they were fishermen. Come, follow me, Jesus said. I will send you out to fish for people. And at once they left their nets and they followed him. And when he had gone a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay, he called them. And they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men, and they followed him. Thus ends the reading of this morning's gospel. Let's have a quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for these stories that we've got this morning. Help us as we unpack them to absorb the spiritual lessons that are here to be gathered from them. Thank you for this time together. This is not my time, but this is your time, Lord Jesus. We invite you to be here and to speak to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, you may be seated. So this morning, I decided to, I'm flipping all over here, to title this morning's message, From the Pit to the Peak. So here we see an image. It's some artist's conception of being in a dark, dark cavern, gloomy, depressive, and here we have some mountain with some climber who has ascended to the top of that peak. So in this gospel this morning, we find a very interesting sub-story. In those very few words, there was a total change of citizenship. You notice as Jesus came walking along, how he invited these four fishermen from one world into another world, and that was the world of Jesus. So when Peter and Andrew and James and John went to work that morning, they went strolling down the beach like they always did, down to where their boats were. They got into the boat, they started preparing the boats for the fishing, for the going through the nets, cleaning all of that stuff up. Their intent that morning when they went to work was to just go and catch some fish, make a little bit of money, go home, probably spend it on something. They were honorable, hard-working, honest men. They were also, we might say, on the merry-go-round of life. Every single day, get up, head down to the boat. We're a gerbil on a treadmill. Around and around and around we go. How well I relate to that. How much of my life is spent just on that same treadmill. But there's another little sub-story, and we didn't read that one this morning, but I've used it in the past. Across the Sea of Galilee, here's these four men, honest, hard-working, good, respectable men going to work. On the other side of the Sea of Galilee, high, high up on a mountain, probably on that same morning, because the Bible says he had been there for a long time by the time Jesus got there. There was a much, much more interesting man. He was crazy, demon-possessed, sleeping on a rock behind a tombstone, hair disheveled, chains on his arms and his wrists, and cutting himself with stones, the Bible says, that same morning. Peter and James and John and Andrew, these guys were looking pretty good. This guy was not looking too good. But they had something very, very, very much in common. Both, or all of their spirits, even though they were good men, these five men, all of their spirits were in a pit of darkness. They were, as the Bible says, separated from God. The Bible teaches us that all have sinned. Every single human being has sinned, and they've fallen short of the glory of God. So whether or not they were an honorable, good, respectable person, or this mostly crazy person with this wild-eyed look on his face, crazy, they were in the same boat. You see, that pit is the pit into which all human beings are born. You and I were born into that pit. Have you ever noticed a toddler? Do you have to teach a toddler to say, "Mine"? Do you have to teach a toddler to be rebellious and say, "No"? Rebellion, selfishness, all of these things, that we're born into the same pit. So whether that was the honorable fisherman or this crazy man, they're all in the same boat. And I want to just modernize this just for a second here. We are all this, just like the demoniac. No. You might be a citizen of the pit of darkness, as we all are, and be living in this modern hell. Picture of a guy living in the pit of darkness. We might consider him as the demoniac. Or this might be you. You could be firmly believing that the answer to life is in, well, in my case, probably losing weight and getting back in shape again. There was a time that I did look like this. You laugh! But the fact of the matter is, yes, you might, but he's still in the pit of darkness. Doesn't really matter if he's looking like this or if he's looking like this. The truth is, just like these fishermen and the demoniac, everybody is in the same boat. Or this might be you. You might be a citizen, you may be a citizen of the kingdom of darkness, and yet you can be living in a neighborhood like this. But don't let it fool you. The emptiness of the pit is just as real in this place as it is in this place. There's no difference. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And there we sit, stuck. No possible way that we can redeem ourselves. A quick word about some of the citizens of this particular kingdom of darkness. There's a lot of them. A lot of people have the nerve to claim that they have got the answers to life. From the first picture here, there was probably a drug dealer somewhere along the line in this guy's life that came to him and said, "You're depressed, are you? What you need is this. Take this pill. Take this. It'll make you feel better. Take a drink. It'll make you feel better." From the second picture, there are certainly people, and we know them, we speak to them all the time, who will tell us that really the way out of the pit of darkness is to do this. And there's no doubt it makes us feel much better. We wake up with a lot more energy and all of that kinds of that sort of a thing. But the truth is just as real here. There are people, even in the church, who will tell you that this is the answer to finding purpose in life. I could put more pictures up here. I could put a picture up here of someone telling us that if we simply reduce our carbon footprint, all our problems will go away. There are prophets among us in our society who will tell you that if you could only change your gender, all of the problems in your life would be saved, would be repaired. And of course, there are always people who say one of two things. The politicians. If we gave the government all the power, it'd be all perfect. If we gave the government none of the power, everything would be perfect. My point is just this. It's way bigger than all of these little discussions. My point is this. There are two kingdoms. There are two kingdoms. There is the kingdom of darkness and there is the kingdom of light. And our stories from Jonah this morning talk about a prophet who walked into a city of sin and nailed the people to the wall with a message of repentance. Turn, or God will destroy you. Jesus came with the same message in this particular story. It's a little bit different. He said, come and follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. Now, here's my question. I rattled off six groups of people who were quite verbose about having the answer to life. They're all in the same camp. Jesus places himself in an entirely unique, singular camp. He said, I am the way, the truth, the life, and no one can come to the Father except by me. Now, is he right? Is he right? My second point, if you're taking notes, the first point was all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The second point is this. Jesus Christ is the answer. I don't know where you are this morning in your life. Maybe things are pretty good. Maybe they're not too bad at all. Maybe things are just sailing south. Maybe you have no idea what the future is going to hold. Well, none of us really do, but fearful of the future. Jesus Christ is the answer. He said this, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden. Oops. And I will give you rest. Let's talk about this fella for just a minute. Think about where this guy was. This guy was strong enough to literally tear chains apart. The Bible teaches. It says he'd break his bonds and he would run wild in the tombstones. He was probably a very muscular individual, probably an athlete, who knows? It doesn't say anything about that, but clearly he had great strength. And yet, he was in this utter pit of blackness. And I just want to take a few minutes to describe this most awesome of transformations that happens. Here's the thing. Missionaries are out of fashion today. Anybody that's a missionary in our North American culture, kind of frowned upon. It's not trendy. It's not chic to be a Christian. This is basically what you hear. You Christians are so bothersome. You're telling all these people about heaven and hell. Why can't you just be quiet and leave them alone where they are? Or we hear this, you Christians, you may have your truth. You have your truth, but these folks have their truth. And who are you to criticize their truth? You might hear this. You Christians are just nasty and disgusting. You're so judgmental. You're so exclusionary. You keep people out. Well, I want to apply those thoughts and those very phrases to the work and the ministry of Christ. Just one time. Just humor me as I go through this. Jesus, you're so bothersome talking about heaven and hell and demons. Why can't you just leave this guy alone? Just be quiet and leave him alone. Or Jesus, now you may have your truth. But this individual here has got his truth, doesn't he? Are not his views equally as important as yours? Or Jesus, you're so nasty and disgusting and so judgmental. But I'll tell you this. Every single life that allows Jesus Christ to touch them deeply, personally, is transformed utterly. This guy may not look... A well-dressed person may not look this crazy. But they all have the same need, and that is this. Jesus Christ, the one through whom all things were created. He has no problem whatsoever annihilating and shattering the culture of this man that was enslaved by demons. He was perfectly fine with taking this man who was ripping his body apart and freeing him from that so that the next time that Jesus visited that side of the lake, that crazy man had become an evangelist. And the word of the transformation of this life had spread throughout the region so that now, instead of driving him away, people thronged to hear him. The work of one single person, this crazy man. He truly can transform lives. Now, I kind of get it. Sometimes people think, they'll tell me, why do you use all of these modern examples of lives that are changed? Why do you talk about Hulk Hogan? Why do you talk about the Vietnamese girl in the picture? Why do you talk about all of this stuff? Well, my point is pretty simple. The same salvation that Jesus Christ offered to that crazy, crazed, demon-crazed individual in that cemetery is the same salvation that is transforming lives. A couple of weeks ago, I mentioned that. Hulk Hogan got baptized. Is it the answer to all of the world? Do we need to proclaim his salvation? No. But it's very helpful to point out that someone who had everything that Hulk Hogan had, fame, name, power, prestige, money, the worship of people, adulation of fans, found that to be an empty, empty world. Just like that picture of that big mansion, big house, empty. But when Jesus Christ came into his life, all of that was transformed. Now, the third and the final point that I'll make is brief. The point and the purpose to Jesus calling those four men, the point and the purpose to Jesus redeeming this wild and crazy demon-possessed individual was twofold. One, of course, was eternal salvation. There's the kingdom of darkness. He brought them, and he alone can bring us into the kingdom of light. But there was a second purpose, and we find that in the story of Jonah, and we also find it right embedded into this gospel story this morning. Come, follow me, said Jesus, and I will make you what? Fishers of men. That's the purpose of our life. Because I think probably most of us this morning, truly, have been lifted out of the pit of darkness by Jesus Christ. And truly, we have been placed on a solid rock to stand. But it doesn't end there. The point and the purpose of inviting Andrew, Peter, James, and John to follow him was not just a one-time wash and you're all done and you live your life out the rest of the life. No, the purpose of Jesus' invitation into their life was to give them a purpose to give them a deep, solid, lasting, eternal purpose, and that is to be his messengers. So, where does that leave us? It leaves us on our knees, I think, asking the Lord of glory, what would you have me do? How can I be a fisherman? How can I be a fisherwoman? How can I be a youth with a purpose to serve you? I don't know what that purpose is. We're not stamped out like cookie cutters where we all look and act and do the same kinds of things. We're not. All I can say is that every single one who has been transferred into the kingdom of God by Christ has a purpose, and that is to be a fisherman and a fisherwoman. It might be very small things. It might be simply praying for someone. I talk about this repeatedly. I don't know what God is calling you to do, but I know this. He's calling you to something. He's calling you to something, and there is nobody else quite like you in the kingdom of God anywhere who can fulfill that little purpose. What is it? Spend time before God. Request of him, Lord, what would you have of me? What would you have of me? And I assure you, that this man, who is like no other who has ever lived, he will take you from all of that and he will place you on some kind of a peak. Now, it might be miserable getting there. He didn't promise beds of roses and perfect. He didn't promise perfect finances all the way. He didn't even promise new cars. Most of the disciples had to hoof it where they went. Most of them were killed, except John the Apostle, probably. They were all martyred. He didn't promise rose gardens, but he did promise this. You will have purpose like nothing else on earth, like nothing else that anyone else can offer. This is it. This is where it is. And this is the one who will do it. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, how I bless you for your patience with the demon-possessed, which is all of us. Demon-controlled, demon-guided, disobedient, rebellious, selfish, all of the things that we are. How you have loved us in spite of that. How you invaded the world to change our culture. Thank you for changing my culture. Thank you for bringing light where all there was for me was darkness. Call each one this morning through your Holy Spirit. Nudge. Inspire. Bring us closer to the foot of your cross. I pray this in Jesus' name, for his sake and his glory. Amen. And we're going to share communion again this morning. We have open communion. And so we invite anyone who names the name of Christ as Savior to share in communion with us. You are our brothers. You are our sisters. We are all together one family in Christ. And on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus gave this command, basically. He said, this is very important. This is not something to be taken lightly. One of the very last, final activities that he did with his disciples was this, just this. And he took bread, And if you've got the little communion kits and would like to share in that as we proceed here, feel welcome to do that. Because he took the bread. After supper, he broke the bread and he told his disciples, "This is my body, which is broken for you." And they didn't know what that meant quite yet because his body was still intact. But they were very soon to find out. He says, "Take and eat, because this is my body, and do this in remembrance of me." So let us share together the broken body of our Lord Jesus Christ. And in like manner, following supper, he took the cup, and he raised it, and when he had given thanks, he said, "This is my blood. This is shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. Do this also as often as you share it in remembrance of me." So let us also then share in the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. And now we invite you to come and share the table with us. And now may the body and the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen us, keep us in his grace. Amen. Let's stand and we'll pray together the Lord's Prayer and then close with our closing hymn. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And we'll sing in closing, "Great is thy faithfulness." Following the benediction, we'll have about a 10-minute break, and then we'll have the annual meeting. So those of you that wish to stay for that, please do so. And now receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and to be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Thank you for listening to this message from First United Lutheran Church. Thank you.